Well, good evening, everybody. And I'm Anne Summers, and this is Clementine Ford with her baby son, Frank, 9 weeks old. And it's my great pleasure to be beginning the conversation with Clementine tonight, talking about her book, Fight Like a Girl, which I'm sure you've all seen out on your way in and will be available for sale afterwards. I want to start by just a couple of quotes from the book. In fact, I could spend the entire 40 minutes just reading quotes from the book because this is such an incredibly exciting book for me. And those of you who have already seen it will know that I've written a cover blurb for it in which I say, this is the book I've been waiting for. It's an impassioned call to action for girls of all ages. And I think we can include boys and the girls if they're on our side. There are so many things in this book that I want to talk about, and I know we won't get through them all, but I'll do my best. But I just do want to say to you that it's a fantastic read, and I'll just give you two examples. Clem says, this book is a love letter to the girls. It's a letter to the bitches and the broads, the sluts and the whores. It's to the troublemakers and the rebels, the women who are told they're too loud, too proud, too big, too small, or not enough of nothing at all. So that's all of us, right? Mm-hmm. Here we are. Now, I'd just like to start the conversation, Clem, by reading another quote from the book. And she says, Clementine says, I think back on my teenage years now with a mixture of sadness and wonder. My face is frozen in artificial smiles across albums full of photographs, but inside is a swirling storm of anxiety, self-doubt and loneliness. I wanted desperately to be liberated from the discomfort I felt in my own skin, but I also didn't believe I deserved anything more than that. Now, I could have written those words about my own teenage years, and I'm, I think, probably 40 years older than you, and so I found reading this a very sad experience because it said to me, well, what's changed? And so I guess what I wanted to ask you is, do you feel that life has just not changed at all for girls in the past 40 years? And do you think in the subsequent 20 years, is it any better? Huge question, but just to get us going.
It's funny because that sense of reflection has been echoed by lots of people who've read the book from all different generations. That sense of feeling like, in the book I describe myself as feeling like I was a nothing girl because I didn't feel like I knew in some way that I wasn't able to articulate and I didn't have the language around me to articulate. I knew that there were things that girls were expected to be. Of course, we all grow up with that sense that we have to be pretty, we have to be small enough, we have to apologise for the fact of our feminine existence by taking up as little space as possible, both physically and emotionally. And I knew that I wasn't able to do it physically. I knew that I didn't have the negotiating power of being pretty enough or small enough or slight enough or favourable enough in the eyes of boys around me. That all of those little things seemed to me that even though the experience generally of being a girl was one which hurt and one in which we didn't have a lot of power, having those things at least carved out some tiny, tiny little corner of power. And if you didn't have that at all, what were you? You had no purpose. Hence, you were a nothing girl who had nothing to offer.
But did you have that feeling at the time, or is this looking back, are you putting this construct on it?
I wouldn't have described it like that at the time, but I definitely didn't feel like I was worth anything, and I didn't feel like I didn't know what place there was for me because I didn't have the ability to be what I was supposed to be as a girl. So what did that make me? If you can't even fulfill that, then you just have no point. And I think that that is maybe what resonates with so many of the readers when they think this could be describing my childhood, is that we're surrounded by people who want to tell us what a girl is and what a girl should be and certainly what a girl shouldn't do and should do. And yet there's not a lot of respect for all of the different things that we are.
Well, I guess my question is also, if 30 or 40 years on from my adolescence, you're feeling the same way, why is this? It's because there are no women around you in public places that you can look to and say, well, that's also a girl. You know, the Prime Minister's a girl, or the Governor General's a girl, or the person reading the news is a girl. I mean, none of those things, we're not going to call them things, but there weren't women in those positions at all when I was a teenager. So and things have changed.
We have, you know, legislation has changed, obviously, and we have more representation, not equal representation, and there's still a lot more people just aside from the broad banner of girl who aren't being really represented at all. But I think that people make the mistake and have always made the mistake of thinking that, and it's convenient for them to make this mistake because essentially they don't want feminism to be a successful project at all. But they make the mistake of saying, well, we've got all this legislation that's been passed and therefore equality exists, without appreciating the fact that actually you don't change people's minds as quickly as you change the law books. And if you have legislation that says that, you know, if you have legislation that says that it's illegal to rape your wife in marriage, it doesn't mean that all of a sudden men who are inclined to do that are going to be like, well, I can't do that anymore because the law says it's wrong, therefore morally I understand that it's wrong. In the same way that if you have legislation that says it's illegal to pay men and women different amounts for the same work, it doesn't stop that from happening and people saying, well, she's just not very good at negotiating a salary.
And see, that's one thing that has not changed in 30 years, not changed at all. The 17 to 18% pay differential. When I was running the Office of the Status of Women in 1983, I used to say, well, you know, we've gone from 67% to 81% in a matter of 10 years, so we'll have equality probably in 5 years. And yet it didn't move. It has not moved since the early 80s. And so you're right, you know, the fact that it's against the law means nothing.
And if I can just recount a very quick anecdote, a woman that I know is an architect, and as I understand it, architecture is one of the worst industries for the pay gap to exist. And I feel like this is how the social legislation is perpetuated, in that she was working for this firm in Melbourne. She no longer works for them, but a guy who was a recent graduate of architecture started working at the firm, and she was given the loose, unofficial role of being his supervisor. And so she was doing that. Ostensibly, you'd think that this marks her as a in a position of authority over him. And then one day they were given each other's pay slips by mistake, and she realised that he was being paid somewhere in the region of $5,000 to $8,000 a year more than she was. And of course she was, furious, but also she understood that she was working in a particularly sexist firm in an already sexist industry, didn't feel like she had any bargaining power anyway. And this is, for me, like the kind of the crux of the issue, is that the guy, nice young guy, came to her and said, gave the payslip back, and I said, well, what did he say about it? And she said, well, he was very embarrassed. And I said, but, like, what else did he do? And she said, well, he was just embarrassed about it. And logically, you think, well, of course, he doesn't have to do anything. He's not going to go to the boss and say, well, I think that you should be paying me less. And he's certainly not going to go and say, I think you should be paying me more, paying her more. So what happens then is that he is embarrassed for a moment in time. And because he doesn't like the feeling of being embarrassed and what it implies about his privilege and his role in that company, very quickly he can start to listen to the messages around him that say, well, if you're being paid more, it's probably because you impressed them more than she did. It's probably because they see more potential in you.
You're worth more.
It's probably because you're worth more. And then that's how people then go on and internalise those ideas that they're worth more, they're worth less. And women start to feel afraid, or well, not start to, we've always felt afraid of pushing for what we're actually owed, because we've been taught to feel grateful for the tiny amount that, because we never used to have it. You didn't used to have it. We gave it to you. We gave you the vote. And we could take it away. Well, they can't really, but...
Well...
There's a whole bunch of people in America right now
there is
who
a
want
movement.
To repeal the 19th.
Repeal the 19th Amendment movement, yes. Well, we might get on to America in a minute. We'll stay here for the time being. I mean, one of the things you say in the book is what you want. What I guess one of the number of objectives that come out of the book, but one of them is you say you want us to learn how you can be a girl in a way that does not hurt. So what will that look like? What will that feel like?
I think that being a girl still hurts in lots of ways, and you know, there's actual incidents that can occur that make being a girl hurt very much, and then there's just that slow kind of like chipping away, you know, like the death by a thousand cuts thing. Every sexist joke that you hear, which is just one more slap on the sunburn, that other people who don't have that experience of hearing it every day think well, it's enough to just say, "Oh, you're just being oversensitive. Just get over it." But to sort of like constantly hear the message that being a girl and to do anything like a girl, hence the title, is to be a bit shit at it and to just to be nothing or to be less than somehow, that it helps to perpetuate that cycle of feeling like you do have to apologize for your existence. You do have to be nice every time you're angry about something. So you have to swallow that anger down. You have to be clever about the way that you say things, and even then you won't get what you want. So I feel like that's what hurts, is this constant, this feeling that you constantly have to kind of be playing some kind of game and negotiating your way through this hostile terrain. And when you try and describe the hostile terrain to the people who not only have created it but are benefiting from it, they're like, well, that's all in your head. That's not the,
that's not the world we live in. That's where Donald Trump's done us all a big favour, hasn't he? Because it's out there on the television every night. You look at it and there it is. We don't have to make the case anymore. There it is. He's behaving
but
like that.
But there are still even people who say, well, no, he's just having a laugh. And I think that in a way that's also one of the ways that it hurts. It's from the literal feeling that you're just banging your head against a brick wall and dealing with it. It's like every which way they can sort of snake their way around something, they will. And so it's you just kind of end up being consumed by your own frustration.
So, I mean, one of the things that you do talk about is anger and the need for us to get angry and to take action. And there's couple of chapters in the book that I found particularly riveting, and the one that's called Hate Mail in particular. I mean, one of the big issues that Clementine's been involved with, that I'm sure everybody knows, is the whole issue of online abuse, and you've copped a lot of abuse for what you've written, and you have a policy of fighting back, particularly on Twitter. And I follow this with great interest, and I know that I've often thought to myself, well, you know, doesn't happen to me as much. I guess it's an age thing, I don't know, but if it does, I block or I delete. And you say, no, you don't block and you don't delete, you fight back. And I've found your chapter incredibly persuasive. So I've come around now to your revenge methods. I found, you know, having years of putting up with all this stuff, I still found the descriptions and some of the things that have been said about you online by these guys just frankly unbelievable. It's just the level of hatred
and
hostility is just mind-blowing.
Usually in some kind of argument that men aren't abusive or men don't abuse women, you fucking cunt.
Yeah. It's the one that I've said, you know, you would gibber less with a cock in your mouth. You know, stuff like this, like just routinely as a response to a political argument that she might be making in a tweet post. And I also found, you know, Tim Blair, who you and I, we've both been targeted by him. I think we were in competition, weren't we, to be Fright Bats of the Year?
We were. I don't think either of us won.
No, unfortunately.
I did give it a red hot go.
Yes. Yeah. Tim Blair, for those of you who haven't had the displeasure, is a News Limited, of course, writer. and he specialises in abuse, and he particularly likes abusing women who are feminists. But, I mean, he's come up with this description of you. He calls you Kankles McBaby Stopper. Well, that's clearly inaccurate.
But don't you know that I murdered two of my children?
Oh, of course.
By having disgusting abortions.
Yeah. Well, that's the other thing I really liked about the book, is the way you talk about
abortion. But I'm also too fat and ugly for anyone to have sex with. And that's why I'm so angry.
So let's come to Michael Nolan. And I think I really think it's worth asking Clem to just describe very briefly why she took the action she did, because this is probably of all the things you've done in your life, this is the one that's generated the most apoplexy amongst the boys. Clem was subjected to some pretty vitriolic stuff by this guy who actually used his real name, so she was able to work out who he was and to discover that he actually, his Facebook avatar had his wife and kids in it.
No. That's no? Different guy? Actually, what had happened was it was the gibberless with a cock in your mouth man.
Oh, okay.
Had a photograph of him with his two kids. And so I screen capped, he left that comment on my Facebook page, I screen capped it and posted it as is one of my methods is to put them on signal boost, because one thing that they'll often do is accuse me of censoring them, because I do actually block and delete sometimes, just when I can't be bothered. And that censorship, that's me not being able to handle debate or criticism. So he said, you gibberless with a cock in your mouth. And I posted that photo and said, it's really disturbing how many of these men have kids. And, puts to rest that idea that men with children can't possibly be misogynistic at all. Mm. And I posted that, and on that post, what Michael Nolan said was not really that bad in the grand scheme of things that have been said to me, but he just commented, slut. And I thought it's just, the word itself is not the worst thing, but the fact that he had come to a post where essentially a man was saying that I needed to be mouth raped to shut me up, and his response was not, oh, my God, like, this is disgusting that this man is giving us, putting us in such a bad light, but just to say slut. So I went to his Facebook page. He didn't have wife and kids. He was a single young guy, and he had listed his employer on the Facebook page. So I just sent them a message with this screen cap saying that this man advertises himself as an employee of your company, and I don't appreciate him leaving these messages on my page. And then, of course, posted it also on my page so that they knew that all these other people had seen it. And then what was interesting about that afterwards, and it's kind of been a little bit on display this week with the story of the tram, which some of you may be familiar with. Mm. A man was harassing women on a tram, and then all of a sudden it was completely repackaged by people who weren't there as something completely different. All of a sudden, Michael Nolan lost his job, and then he suddenly had a wife and children who would now be destitute and forced to live on the street.
Because of you.
Because of me, before Christmas. so the kiddies would be getting no presents from Santa this year. And it was just, the abuse was just, it was like messages in the hundreds per day. You slut, you fucking whore, how dare you? And the idea behind it was, how dare I stand up for myself? It's just a word. You can't fucking handle words. Mm. But I've never seen anyone more sensitive on the internet than a white man who feels like his privilege is being taken away from him. and it was just, it was like, how dare you interfere with a man's rights this way? How dare you force him to be accountable for his behaviour? Mm. Who do you think you are?
I mean, I think this is what is so powerful about the whole book, but particularly about this chapter where Clem documents, and I think you've done an incredibly important public service so that people can, you can't argue with it. I mean, the fact that these people have said this stuff to you is just so repulsive. And, there is this sort of continuum between, doing the supposed anonymity of online commentary to, somebody who thinks he can be president of the United States mouthing off on television today about one of the women who's accused him of groping. He's saying, "What? Look at her." That's his response. Look at her. Mm. As if, the fat, disgusting slob like me would be interested in that beautiful young girl.
I only reserve my sexual assault for the attractive ones.
But anyway, there's so many things we've got to cover in a very short time. But I'd like to come, just quickly touch on violence, because there is, a continuum between this violence on the page and the actual physical violence. And you... and I just want to make a little mark something that I noticed today on Twitter, and that is today would have been the 28th birthday of Stephanie Scott, the young woman who was raped and murdered in the Riverina about a year ago, and her parents asked that everybody who wanted to remember her at 3 o'clock this afternoon have a cup of tea and a mint slice, because that's what she used to enjoy doing in her break after school. She was a teacher. And Clementine talks a lot in her book about Jill Maher and a very similar story of a young woman in Melbourne who worked at the ABC who was attacked and raped and murdered walking home at night. And one of the things that you argue in the book, that we've actually perhaps learnt a little bit from these two experiences, from Jill Maher's experience, and I would argue Stephanie Scott, and because perhaps these are middle-class women that are like us, we can put ourselves in their positions. We know women like them. Somehow it resonated more with us than the murder of an anonymous woman that we don't know or we can't identify with.
Well, and also because pretty young white women are considered, of anyone, to be the most innocent. You know, other women aren't innocent. Poor women aren't innocent. Black women aren't innocent. Disabled women aren't innocent. But pretty young white women, well, they're the ones. I mean, look at the way that Donald Trump has been speaking, and it's only, he can say whatever he wants about anyone else, but it's only when he, when maybe there's a risk to pretty young white women, that all of a sudden, all of the Republicans at least are coming out and saying, well, ooh, I don't know, I think maybe we need to distance ourselves from him now. Well, not our women.
Yeah. So they call it the pearl choker. I guess we could spend a lot of time on this, but I want to come back to feminism. And one of the things you say in your book is that you find feminism, you found feminism consoling, that it was something that gave, I mean, there's a wonderful quote here where you say that feminism gave you two gifts. One was a sense of community among like-minded individuals, and you found that very powerful and liberating. And secondly, it taught me that my thoughts and feelings were real. But at the same time, you say that contemporary feminism has perhaps become too conciliatory, and some of the things that are being done at the moment, like the White Ribbon Organisation or like the Male Champions of Change, are too conciliatory. We're letting these guys off the hook, that we need a different kind of feminism. What do you think we need?
I think we need a feminism first and foremost that allows women to be the leaders of it. And, you know, it's like we've bought the lie once again that to get anything done and to be given, we need to get over this idea that someone is there waiting to give us our rights as opposed to us taking back what rightfully belongs to us. You know, no one gave women the vote. Women went through significant hardship. And even then, you know, only some women got the vote. So I think that the idea that we need to be nice to men, firstly, it doesn't work. It allows the structures to remain in place because all you're doing is replicating subservience to patriarchy by saying, oh, you're so nice, thank you so much. Thank you, can we have a ceremony, please, that where we give all of these men an award and we make sure that, you know, they can all stand up on stage and we can congratulate them. Of course, women will do all the catering for it and we'll send out all the invitations and we'll make sure that everyone's invited. But the ones who consider themselves to be good men, it certainly doesn't change the minds of the bad men. And the ones who consider themselves good men get to then go, oh yeah, well, I'm one of them. That's all my involvement needs to be because I am just one of the good guys, so I don't need to do anything else. Whereas when you say there is more to being a good guy than just not being a bad guy, and you actually have to challenge your own privilege and you have to challenge your own behaviour, and no, I'm not going to sit here and reward you and say thank you very much for, you know, not harassing me today. I think initially that message is met with a sense of, but wait a minute, but I'm being nice to you. And then the actual good allies will start to engage with what that means and they will become more more comfortable with not being catered to or for and will actually start working within their own circles, hopefully, to create change.
I think, you know, speaking as somebody who's been around for a while.
I mean, it must just be so frustrating for you, Anne, to just see the same conversations being had.
Yes. I was actually having this conversation a week ago tonight with somebody on this very subject because I was saying, well, look, I remember back when I was in the Office of Status of Women, which is 30 years ago, and we had a program called the Affirmative Action Pilot Program. And what that was is the Prime Minister got 28 companies of, you know, top ASX 200 companies to trial affirmative action employment policies prior to us introducing legislation in 1986. And so they weren't called male champions, and it wasn't quite as personalised as the current effort, but it was a very similar thing. You had companies doing the right thing, being very publicly and doing it with for political and getting a lot of kudos for it. And then what happened? What happened? Well, I'll tell you what happened. John Howard happened. Mm. That's what happened. 1996, the whole world changed, and all these things that had been done during the 80s, all these really good things that had been done, were just ripped up.
Somewhere
and we were sent back to behind the white picket fence to be good little, you know, wives and mothers.
Somewhere there's a split dimension where all the world's problems have been solved and changed, and Australia's actually an incredible place to live. You know, it's sort of a little bit like that UN thing that I think I mentioned briefly in the book about the He for She program, which is another mechanism to make it appear that something's being done and also that men are leading the charge, where nothing actually really is accomplished by that. And with that one in particular, it's even more cynical because, you know, the United Nations launched this big thing, this He for She campaign, and Emma Watson, you know, bless her, nothing wrong with her, but Emma Watson gave this big speech about it and talked about how feminism would liberate men as well. But I signed up for that He for She website just because I thought, oh, this sounds like bullshit, so I'll see whether or not anything comes of it. Signed up for it. Literally all it was just pressing a button to pledge to be a he for she. There was no actual definitive information on the website about the different ways that girls experience violence around the world.
And no action to take?
No action to take. Mm. And there's been no... They have my email address and I have yet to receive an email from he for she. Mm. But most significantly about that was that the Millennium Development Goals, which were meant to be achieved by 2015 when He for She was launched, was very clear that the one that definitely wouldn't be achieved and was the furthest away from being achieved were the ones with to do with gender equality, specifically to do with the maternal mortality rate and to do with gender equity around the world. So if you're the United Nations and you're like, oh, well, shit, we haven't like put enough effort into this because quite clearly it's seen as being quite low down on our list. And when UN Women was launched, countries like the United States donated a paltry $1 million to it, which is nothing. Well, what do? You launch He for She, and then you can just quietly sort of dismiss the fact that the actual things that would create change are not being done. And also, to all of the men who were sitting around in that room going, oh, yep, I'll be a he for she, I'm a representative for my company. Why did none of them look around and go, I think that there are maybe too many men in this room. Maybe what we need to do is work on getting more women in the United Nations, and maybe as men what we can do is sit down.
Oh, and what about our Secretary General? First time in 70 years was the big opportunity to appoint a woman Secretary General this year. And there were six qualified women. Six really qualified women. So you couldn't sort of say, well, she doesn't work because she's from the wrong region. Mm. Or, you know, there were six women to choose from, and it would have been fantastic if Helen Clark had got it because she's from our region and we know her and she's great. But there were other women who were as qualified who could, and of all those six women, no, it's this guy no one's ever heard of from Portugal, apparently he's a great guy, but you know, this was an opportunity for the UN to make a statement about women and they failed to do it.
But I'm sure that those women are knocking on the door. Remember what Tony Abbott said about the cabinet? That they're, you know, they're not in there yet, but they're knocking on the door. So yeah, and behind the door was 19 men holding it shut.
So we've got it. I mean, I recall Quentin Bryce, just after she stopped being Governor General, she was down in Melbourne and she gave a speech to a girls' school, and she spoke to these girls and she said three things to them. She said, be bold, be bold, be bold. Mm. And I thought that was a very terrific thing for her to say, and I think you know, one of the things that women of my generation would like to be able to say to girls who are teenagers today is you have to be bold, you have to have courage, you have to not be scared of the world, you have to not be scared of being a girl, and being a girl should be a terrific, empowering thing. Mm. Do you think that's happening?
I think that it's more promising now than it felt like it.
Tell us the story about the 12-year-old girl.
I got an email from this. She looked like she was about 12 or 13. This girl yesterday who sent me a photograph of herself holding my book at the bookstore, and she said, "I just wanted you to know that I bought your book today with my birthday voucher." And I just thought that was just fantastic. Mm. I think it is happening. I think that one of the great benefits of social media and of the internet is, despite all of the horrific ways that boys can use it, boys and men of all ages can and are using it to abuse women and to try and put us back in our little place, you know, get back in the kitchen with all their original jokes. Despite all of that, and that can be a horrible thing for a lot of girls to experience, the benefit of it is that they're actually seeing now communities of women that they can join and that they can find that solidarity with other women. They don't even need to be in the same room to do the consciousness raising anymore. And they can back each other up and support each other when this kind of hostility is being directed their way. You know, I see women now, the thing that I like so much is not so much using the rage against trolls online, but just laughing at them, because they hate that more than anything. They hate being ridiculed by women. And seeing all of these women kind of band together to laugh at the man babies is, I think, a really positive sign.
But do you... one of the things,
I think it does need to sort of go somewhere.
Yeah, but. I mean, one of the things that concerns me is that there's a lot of activity online, and I agree with you, it's a fantastically empowering thing, and it's a fantastically efficient way of communicating with, you know, very large numbers of people very quickly and immediately. You can get information out. But when it comes to actually doing things... And what I was saying to Clem before is that I think that her book either needs a second volume or an addendum. Which, of a manifesto, of a call to, of actually a checklist of what needs to be done, of what we have to do, because we can get angry, we can certainly get riled up, and your book will make us angry, but then what are we going to do? I mean, we can go online and laugh at these boys, but... there's got to be a checklist of what we have to do or what needs to be done to actually change things. And that, I think, is the hard part.
This is just one idea, and the fear around it is that you would try and organise it and it wouldn't work, and then it would be used as an example of why women can't organise anything.
But we can.
We can.
We've proved that we can.
We certainly can. I was thinking about the Polish strike that was organised to protest the legislation, which was enormously successful and showed exactly how essential women are to any, to the support of any economy. And then I was thinking about the Iceland day off in 1975, and I thought, well, what if women in Australia organised something like that as well, where we took the day off from all of the work that we do, and not just the economic industrial work that we do, but we actually took the day off from the childcare and the domestic work that we do as well, so that if we have male partners and children, not only are they left with no women in the workplace to support them, but they have to make that decision of, well, what do I do with my kids today? I can't actually go into work. I've got to stay at home with the children because she's on strike. And then that is actually really a way to shut down industry.
I think I'd build up to that.
I know, but I'm saying that imagine if you could do something like that. But then I thought, well, that's impossible to do that on a national scale. So what if, like, just
not impossible, but I think, you know,
what if small communities did it? You know, what if a community like Geelong said, today we are not doing the childcare, and that means we're not going to take them to the childcare. The women who, you know, overwhelmingly work in childcare centres for ridiculously low pay are not going to be at the childcare centres. It's a risk, because I think one of the problems is that we live in a current climate in which there is too much focus on the individual. And when I say too much focus on the individual, I don't mean that individual needs and identities are not important, but that to put aside that for a day could be effective, except that some people legitimately do think, well, I can't afford to not go to work for this day. I can't afford to risk my job.
And I think there's another fact.
Someone else will do it.
You're asking women to do something that they haven't done before. I mean, one of the things that I argue in the new edition of Damned Horse and God's Police where I addressed the question of whether or not we still have those two stereotypes in Australian society and what they look like in modern day Australia. And I've, you know, reached a conclusion reluctantly that I think that a lot of women would rather modernise the God's police stereotype rather than get rid of it. And so women, we want the right to do all these things in addition to being terrific wives and mothers. And we're not going to give up that area of power. A lot of women won't. And that's, now you talk about internalised misogyny in your book, and in some ways that's the same thing, that we can't actually give up the one area of control that we have, which is the kids. And
I'd love to give up the control of the kid.
Okay, we've got one.
But yeah, I know what you mean. And partly I think that because, I mean, there is a different... If you're the person who's carried the child, there is a different sense of... And I'm not saying like in a wishy-washy kind of like, oh, I'm spiritually connected to my baby. But it's more just that I think it's imprinted in those early days where you are the last... line of defense. You know, you are the last person that will be forced to care for this child. If everything else falls away, like, you're the only one who's going to do it. And maybe there's also the problem as well with some relationships where they kind of like reinforce those ideas that the man can't do it as well as the woman. Yeah. You know, she won't let him hold the baby, or and maybe that comes back to as well the sense that like one of the only things that women are allowed to be proud of doing.
It's an area of power that women have that's uniquely theirs. Look, we're going to go to audience questions in a moment. I just kind of, my final question, which we've kind of segued into very naturally, is, I mean, you were pregnant with Frank while you were writing this book. This is a very angry book. And I'm just wondering how it felt to be expressing this anger on the page while you were growing this baby inside you?
I don't think that it... I mean, I write a chapter in there about pregnancy and abortion, and I also talk at, you know, in quite great detail about the terrible pregnancy anxiety that I had, that I didn't expect to have. I thought that I would be a candidate for postnatal depression because of my issues with mental health, but it surprised me to feel so awful while I was pregnant. But I don't think that I really felt like it was... I feel like I've always been able to separate the two, you know? Like, it's quite easy to slip into the writing side of things and not focus so much on the physical side of things. So it just they just seemed like two completely different things to me, you know, in much the same way that I found it relatively easy to do a, you know, to do a book tour, or do, you know, be doing all this crazy work in the first couple of months of his life. Relatively easy. Yeah. Because I don't sort of see them as being, I don't know, like I don't see one as excluding the other from happening. The one thing that is difficult is that I did do a talk the other day, and I was talking about Damien Little, who was the man who drove his two sons off the wharf in Port Lincoln. And it was the first time that I'd read out loud a story of, you know, in a man killing his children. And that kind of hit me in a way that I didn't expect, that speaking the words out loud when I had suddenly had this whole new concept context for it was very difficult.
Hi, Clem. I've lost my voice. I was listening to Michelle Obama's speech today on the internet, and it really resonated with me about what she was talking about, the horrendous things that are going on over there at the moment. And someone asked her about, well, how do you see that? How can we solve this issue? And, you know, and I was thinking of Australia, and she had a really, came up with a really good idea, and she said, well, why don't we have two presidents, a male and a female? And that way, if we did have two prime ministers in Australia, at least the female, and I'm not saying that the female prime minister would look after all the feminist issues, but at least there would be balance.
Somebody might.
Yeah, I know.
I think that the risk and the problem with something like that is that, firstly, I think that what would end up happening is that the woman looked after the woman stuff, but also that there are so many more things that need to be represented than... It would still end up probably just being a white man and a white woman, and that wouldn't address the need for diversity in other areas? And then what? Then do you have a prime minister for each? Well, that's just having a minister for a portfolio. But on that note, I do think it's interesting that we got so rightly upset about the fact that Tony Abbott made himself the prime minister for women, and how like absurd that was. And yet, to my knowledge, I don't think that there's ever been a minister for Indigenous issues who's actually Indigenous. And I just think it's interesting that we don't sort of focus, that doesn't seem to kind of become part of the conversation. So I feel
you
like...
See, I had a... Can I make a comment when you finished on that? Yeah.
No, please.
No, I just had a completely different... I mean, the only person in Australia, apparently, but, you know, I took on all comers on this. Because when I worked for Bob Hawke, he was the Minister for Women. I mean, to me, having the women's portfolio in the Prime Minister's department, having the Prime Minister responsible for women is what we want. We want to be in the most powerful part of the government.
Maybe we just don't want Tony Abbott to be the Prime Minister.
I think that's what it was. I think it was the individual rather than... But two things got conflated. We said, well, we can't have a man as a Minister for Women. Well, I don't see why not.
Yeah.
What matters is what happens, what's done. Or as at the moment, what's not being done. So, yes.
My question is about the modern economy and the effect of the casualisation of the workforce on women and women's career prospects. I work in education and it's mind-boggling the amount of casual work that is the only work that's available for women with postgraduate qualifications in a field. I know it applies to men as well, but I think casualisation... overwhelmingly affects women and their career prospects, and I think it's getting worse now.
Well, yeah, no, I don't have a solution for that, but I think that you're right that that's really very present and has a huge impact on women, particularly because they end up the industries. I mean, I'm no expert on this at all, so I'll probably say something wrong here, but it seems to me that the industries that end up being casualised suffer the same attitude as the industries that end up being feminised, which is that the more feminised an industry becomes, the less value it's considered and the less difficult it's considered to be, so the lower the pay rate becomes. And then with the casualised workforce, there's no job security. Women we know are retiring with, if they even get to retirement age, retiring with much lower superannuation levels. And Anne and I were talking before this started about how the fastest growing group of homeless women in the country are women over the age of 65. Which kind of like, it doesn't really answer your question what I'm going to say, but does make, something I've been thinking about lately is how absent feminists of my generation and younger feminists, how absent older women are from the conversations that we're having, and why that's something that needs to change and that's something that we should be focused on, not just because it's a really important issue of equality, but also because unless we die, every one of us is going to end up old. And the one currency that we might have as younger women is, you know, the currency of youth, but that's going to be taken away from us, and then we'll just become old women and no one cares about them, not even young feminists, it seems.
And I think what I would add to that I wish that young feminists would take up some economic issues, that, you know, the concentration on some of the issues that you talk about in your book, particularly violence, are incredibly important, but also economic issues are vital. If we can't support ourselves...
Because you've done a lot of work about women and superannuation.
A bit, but yeah, I mean, but the point is that, you know, I think the three principles for women to have an independent existence, firstly, you've got to have financial self-sufficiency, which means goes to education, employment and equal pay. Secondly, we've got to be able to control our fertility, which goes to, you know, contraception, abortion. And thirdly, we've got to have freedom from violence. And with those three things, you know, we're fine. We can, everything else will fall into place. But the economic stuff, I just think young feminists need to get a lot more involved in these economic issues. And we have to demand of governments that they treat these issues of workplace, of casualisation, part-time work. I mean, the thing about women's workforce participation in Australia, we have got the highest rate of part-time work in the Western world. So that, you know, the vast majority of married women who work are in part-time work with the commensurate lower pay, lower conditions, lack of superannuation, all the rest of it. So that, as well as casualisation, is a huge issue for women, and it's something that I think I'd love to hear some young voices taking up as well.
I think partly the reason that I don't focus so much on that is because I'm a little intimidated about... And this is I'm not saying that's an excuse. I think that this is something, obviously, I need to work through, but I'm intimidated at speaking about the economy and getting it wrong.
And I so you interview somebody.
I'm not saying that it's an excuse, but I think that that's something that it kind of goes to that whole thing about what do we need to do as girls anyway, which is to stop being so afraid of... Because we know that if we do, we're going to be judged 10 times as harshly, and even if we say things that are correct, then they'll be told that we're wrong anyway. If you actually feel like you don't know anything about it, the onus... I hope everyone heard that. He's very good at farting. Takes after his mum. I guess what I'm just saying is that that's a good reminder for me. That's a good wake-up call. Yes.
There was a question here.
Hi, I first want to say congratulations on your book and the birth of your son.
Thank you.
It's a very exciting time for you. This is really nervous.
Deep breath.
Okay. There have been two women in my life that have changed my life, and they both entered my life at the same time, one being you, Clem, and my 4.5-year-old daughter. I always cared about feminism, but nothing really changed it for me until I had a daughter of my own. And I began looking at the world that I was in, and you really helped me to really examine the world and become angry. And my sister and I talk about it all the time, but we are now both very proud to say that we're angry feminists.
Yay! Yes. Clap for that, Frank.
And so, like, there's obviously, like, with a lot of women, I imagine, like, battling, you know, the internalised misogyny and things. And I grew up in a very conservative family, and I'm still fighting that today, that my father always says that I'm very aggressive and, you know, you're overreacting and all these things. Mm. And almost everything that you say in your book and in your online thing, it resonates with me so much. I've been dying to ask you, like I said, you know, my daughter has changed the way I see the world. And you've spoken a lot about rape culture. And obviously that, you know, it gets us all very, very angry. And something that I am struggling with at the moment is how, or do you have any ideas on how I can empower my daughter to make good, safe decisions when she gets to that age without making her feel that she's responsible for preventing rape? Mm. Because it makes me really, really angry that so much of this responsibility is placed on women, and yet I want her to be safe. Mm. I don't want her to be a victim. And I find it really, really hard to bring those two together. Mm. And I was hoping that you might have any kind of advice on that.
You know, when I write about rape culture and about prevention and how prevention education doesn't work because it's always putting the onus on the wrong person, invariably there'll be one or more people who'll say, well, you know, this is unrealistic. How dare you suggest this? Of course we have the right to educate our daughters or to want to keep them safe. To which my answer is always, absolutely. Of course you say to your daughters, be careful when you go out in the street at night. This is the reality for you. We teach, as we have learned from older women ourselves, we teach them things like hold your keys in between your fingers when you're walking to your car. You know, watch out for your girlfriends. Don't take drinks from strange men. I mean, we don't always follow that, but we know what we're supposed to do to keep ourselves safe, which is what makes it so infuriating when people say, when will you girls learn that the world is unsafe? It's like, we bloody well know that the world is unsafe, but the problem is when we talk about the things that we do to address that lack of safety, you suddenly turn it into an issue of, you know, how men are being demonised here. I don't think that you should not teach your daughter those things at all, but what I would like to see more from parents of sons is them teaching their sons to not become conditioned into being the kind of boy that thinks that it's okay to treat a girl like that or to assault a girl. it seems to me that we hear far too much from people, which is not to denigrate your question, we hear far too much from people, how do I raise my daughter to be safe in this world? Or, you know, I'm scared of having a daughter in this world because we know what the world is like for girls. And we rarely ever hear anyone say what I say about having a son, which is I'm scared of having a son in a world that conditions boys to bond with other men over the abuse and dehumanization of women. And how do I raise a son to resist that? How do I raise a son to take a stand against that? And to conceive of masculinity and his masculinity as being... Oh, he's just pissed all over me.
Well, that's what he thinks of that argument.
Yeah. Conceive of it as being something different to that and something that is more liberating for him as well, you know? So that's kind of the project that I'm working on as a parent is... and that I would love to see more people taking up, you know, that the other thing that I often hear is when I say, well, we should be focusing on educating boys. I mean, apart from people saying things like, how dare you suggest that our sons are abusive? Well, someone's abusing the girls. It's like Adrienne Truscott says, you know, like she was sitting in a tutorial when she was at university. Adrienne Truscott's an American circus performer and comedian. And she was sitting there and her professor, thinking he was doing, you know, this right thing by educating the people in the room, was saying, you know, one in three girls, well, women will be raped in her lifetime. And there was sort of like no kind of response from the people in the room. And he was saying, don't you understand what that means? That means that these, you know, however many girls in this room will be raped in their lifetime. Don't any of you have anything to say about that? And Adrienne put her hand up and she said, yeah, I've got something to say about that. Which one of you raped us? Because that's what people don't want to face. Yeah. Too many people are comfortable thinking that they're more comfortable thinking of their daughters as being, comfortable thinking of their daughters as being potential victims than they are of thinking that their sons might become potential perpetrators. Mm-hmm. And because they're too uncomfortable to face that reality, none of them, it seems, are actually having difficult conversations with their boys.
I am definitely going to be having those conversations with my son. I actually find that's a bit easier. I'm like, oh, no, this is how it is. And, you know,
oh, sorry. I'm very, very mindful of that.
Good.
And I will be raising my son to be a feminist. And despite the... I get a lot of flack from that in my family that, you know, like they will... You know, stupid things like, you know, why is he wearing pink? Why does he have frills on his bum? That's the kind of family I've
grown. Oh, my God, he might become gay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God.
Or a girl, even worse.
Even worse.
But I think what you need to do is be the balm against... your family will send in.
I wholeheartedly agree, and I actually feel like that for me is going to be easier I think I should be able to raise my daughter to be a strong woman as well. She's certainly well on her way at 4 and a half, but you know, definitely I really do agree that it is really, really important that we do raise our sons to be respectful, and if anything, it is more important that that we do make them aware of, you know, all of the above.
Well, I think that you and Clem and all of this generation of women should be documenting this project, and you know, you should be creating role models is a stupid term, but creating an environment whereby this is the big discussion that we're having about raising sons. Mm. I mean, it certainly used to happen in the 70s, and again, it got something else that got lost, but it's something that should come back because it's part of what we have to do, I think. Anyway, on that, I'm afraid we've run out of time.
Visit wheelercentre.com for the best in books, writing and ideas from Melbourne, Australia and the world.